The session on women's empowerment is hosted by the Ban Ki-moon Center for Global Citizens. And I had the privilege to introduce myself already. I'm the CEO of the Ban Ki-moon Center. And indeed, we are all targeted at empowering women and the youth, and doing that within the framework of the Sustainable Development Goals. Talking about empowering women is incredibly important. And let me just ask in the audience that is still buzzing from the energy of the break, who of you can already claim that he or she has empowered a woman? Raise your hand. Who has already empowered a woman? Okay, I see some hands up. Yeah. Maybe we need to get a better record. Who of you feels inspired to do so now? That's a better quorum. All right. Ladies and gentlemen, we go back to the basics with women by welcoming the president of KOICA. President Lee, please do come to the stage to give us your setting the tone remarks for this very session on empowerment of women. A warm welcome applause.
Translation 준비하시느라고 시간 좀 걸릴 것 같네요. 예, 저는 1년 전에 코이카 이사장에 취임을 했습니다. 그 취임하면서 코이카가 지속 가능한 목표 달성을 위해 많은 일을 해왔지만 앞으로는 특히 SDG 5, SDG 16 목표, 즉 성평등과 평화, 민주주의, 인권의 가치를 달성하는 데 중점을 두어야 된다 하고 강조를 했습니다. 그동안 코이카는 개도국가 협력 사업에서 농업, 교육, 보건 분야에 주력을 많이 해왔습니다. 이 분야는 사회 발전에서 가장 기초적이고 특히 개도국 주민들에게 직접적인 도움을 준다는 점에서 그 중요성을 아무리 강조해도 지나치지 않다고 생각을 합니다. 이에 비하면은 성평등이나 평화, 민주주의, 인권은 매우 가치지향적이고 추상적이기도 합니다. 하지만 훨씬 근본적인 변화를 가져옵니다. 저는 개발협력이 단지 가난에서 벗어나게 해주고 더 높은 경제성장을 달성하는 것만이 아니라 우리 사회가 성평등하고 인권을 보장하며 평화로워지도록 하는 것을 목표에 두어야 한다고 생각을 합니다. 얼마 전 저는 아프리카 세네갈에서 여성 성기 절제, female genital mutilation cutting, 좀 복잡한 이름이었죠. 이 간섭을 바꾸기 위해서 평생을 헌신해온 몰리 멜칭 여사에 관한 책을 보았습니다. 책을 읽는 동안 한 가지 질문이 내내 맴돌았습니다. 온갖 위험에도 불구하고 무엇이 아프리카 여성들로 하여금 이 운동에 참여하게 만들었을까? 그리고 상당한 성공을 거둘 수 있게 하였을까? 하는 관심이었습니다. 그 가장 큰 동력은 인권 교육이었습니다. 이를 통해서 이 여성들은 여성과 남성도 동등하게 인간으로서의 존엄성을 가지고 있고 인권을 보장받아야 한다는 것을 자각하면서 그 동력이 생겨난 것을 알 수 있었습니다. 더욱 놀라웠던 것은 이 아프리카 여성들이 UN 여성 차별 철폐 협약을 전에 듣고 읽고 하면서 스스로 용기를 얻었다는 점이었습니다. 저는 성평등, 평화, 민주주의, 인권에 대한 개선된 인식이 포괄적이고 지속 가능한 사회를 만드는 원동력이 될 것이라는 점을 확신합니다. 또한 뉴욕에서 체결된 유엔 여성 차별 철폐 협약이 지구 건너편 아프리카 여성들에게 큰 힘이 된 것처럼 인권과 평화를 향한 사람들의 연대는 상상 이상으로 연결되어 있다는 점을 확신하고 있습니다. 저는 코이카 이사장으로 오기 전에 국회의원으로서 20년, 그 이전에는 여성운동가로서 20년을 보냈습니다. 제 나이가 지금 몇 살 정도인지 너무 계산하지 마시기 바랍니다. 네, 좀 나이가 있죠? 네, 1975년 제1차 세계 여성대회가 개최되었고 이후 한국에는 서구의 대학을 중심으로 일어나기 시작한 여성학이 소개되었습니다. 그 중 수많은 여성 관련 서적들이 한국에 들어왔고 저를 포함해서 많은 젊은 여성들이 그 책을 읽었습니다. 그런 가운데 1977년 미국 개발 원조 기관인 USAID가 이화여자대학교에서 여성학 커리큘럼을 도입하는 것을 지원했습니다. 저는 그 프로그램의 연구원으로 참여했습니다. 그로부터 5년 후인 1982년에는 한국의 젊은 여성들이 진보적인 여성운동단체를 만들었고 이 단체는 여성 노동자, 여성 농민들의 인권과 민주주의를 위해 일을 했습니다. 그 당시는 한국이 굉장히 권위주의적인 정부 체제 아래 있었습니다. 그래서 정부가 인권에 대해서 주장하는 것에 대해서 탄압이 있었죠. 그렇기 때문에 이러한 인권에 관한 운동을 하는 단체에 대해서는 단체는 활동을 하는 것도 좀 제약이 있었고 또 모금에도 어려움이 있었습니다. 그런 환경에서 독일의 원조 단체인 EZE의 지원이 큰 힘이 되었습니다. 저는 이때 이 여성단체의 창립 멤버였고 또 단체의 중요한 임원으로서 EZE의 지원을 가장 가까이에서 경험할 수 있었습니다. 제가 활동한 것에 대한 리포트를 내고 회계를 보고하고 이런 일들도 했었죠. 이 경험을 통해서 저는 건강하고 바람직한 공여기관과 수원기관과의 관계가 어떠해야 하는지 하는 것을 배웠던 것 같습니다. 그들은 단순히 지원금을 주는 데 그치지 않았습니다. 수원기관을 무한히 신뢰해 주었고 우리들의 주인의식을 매우 존중해 주었습니다. 또 하나 경험을 공유하고 싶습니다. 1995년 베이징에서 세계 여성 대회가 열렸습니다. 베이징은 한국하고 좀 가깝죠. 나이로비라든지 저기 멕시코 시티라든지 하고는 굉장히 다르잖아요. 그래서 한국 여성들이 가까이에서 열리는 베이징 대회에 우리 꼭 가자 하고 결심을 했습니다. 그래서 대회 1년 전부터 세계 여성 대회 준비위원회를 조직하고 분야별로 스터디 그룹을 통해서 우리의 과제들을 도출을 했습니다. 비행기 값도 1년 전부터 각자가 저축을 하기 시작을 했었죠. 그 저축한 돈으로 저희가 비행기를 통째로 전세 냈습니다. 대단하죠? 예, 통째로 전세 내서 갔고 또 그 통째 전세 비행기에 타지 못하는 여성들은 또 따로따로 오고 그래서 500여 명의 대표단들이 베이징 현장에 찾아가서 세계 각국에서 온 여성들을 만날 수 있었습니다. 그들과 함께 서로의 경험과 문제의식을 공유한 이 시간은 제가 생각할 때 한국 여성들에게 엄청난 에너지를 주었습니다. 세계 여성들 속에서 함께 있으면서 엄청난 에너지를 받고 돌아왔습니다. 그 이후 한국 여성들은 한국 가부장제의 적폐가 가장 잘 드러난 호주제 폐지 운동을 이끌었습니다. 그리고 나중에 호주제를 폐지시켰죠. 또 여성의 정치 참여, 일본군 성노예 문제와 같은 여성 성폭력 문제들을 사회 정치적인 이슈로 만드는 데 성공했습니다. 이런 사례들에서 보듯이 여성들의 운동, 경험, 성공 사례들은 저는 분절되어 있다고 생각하지 않습니다. 아무리 지구 반대편에 있다고 하더라도 서로에게 영향을 주면서 연결되어 있음을 알 수 있습니다. 올해 저는 로힝야 난민 100만 명이 살고 있는 방글라데시 콕스 바자르를 방문했었습니다. 난민들에게 필요한 것이 한두 가지가 아니겠습니다만은 가장 시급한 것 중에 하나가 치사도구였습니다. 그래서 가스버너였습니다. 쌀을 배급받는다 하더라도 조리할 연료가 없어서 날 것으로 먹거나 조리하지 못하거나 날 것으로 먹고 병이 나는 일들이 비일비재하기도 했습니다. 또 여성들과 아동들은 땔감을 구하러 가다가 성폭력을 당하거나 유괴당하는 위험에 노출되기도 했습니다. 게다가 100만 명이나 되는 난민들이 땔감으로 나무를 베어가는 바람에 주위에 울창했던 숲들이 민둥산이 되어가고 있었습니다. 무엇보다도 끔찍했던 것은 여러 로힝야 여성 난민들이 피난 오는 가정에서 또는 피난 오는 가정에서 성폭력이라는 엄청난 지옥 같은 경험을 했다는 것이었습니다. 코이카가 지원하는 로힝야 난민들을 지원하는 NGO가 있는데요. 아디라고 합니다. 아시안 디그니티 이니시에이티브라는 그러한 단체죠. 이 단체는 성폭력을 경험한 여성들의 심리치료를 바로 하고 있었습니다. 특히 여성들의 트라우마를 치료하는 데 그치지 않고 이 여성들이 다른 피해 여성들을 상담할 수 있도록 활동가를 만드는 것까지를 목표로 하고 있었습니다. 그리고 제가 갔을 때 8명의 활동가들이 있었습니다. 어떻게 이런 프로그램을 성공적으로 수행을 했을까? 저는 정말 놀라웠습니다. 어떻게 이 젊은 NGO 여성 활동가들이 이런 생각을 하게 됐지? 하고 저는 매우 궁금했습니다. 그냥 저 혼자서 상상을 해보았습니다. 아마 이것은 한국 젊은 NGO 활동가들이 선배들이 일본군 위안부 피해자들의 인권 회복과 정의 실현을 위해서 지난 30년 동안 투쟁한 그 경험에서 배우지 않았을까 이런 생각을 했습니다. 저는 이 일본군 위안부 활동에 초창기부터 참여했던 한 사람의 활동가였는데요. 이 일본군 위안부 피해자들이 처음으로 자신들의 이야기를 증언한 것은 이들이 그러한 폭력을 당하고 거의 45년이 지난 1991년이었습니다. 45년이나 지났습니다. 이미 이들은 그 당시에 이미 나이든 할머니가 다 되어 있었습니다. 그리고 처음 증언에 나섰을 때 이분들은 단순히 한 사람의 피해자, 한 사람의 생존자였을 뿐이었습니다. 그러나 이들이 인권에 대한 의식을 갖게 되자 그 이후에는 20년, 30년이 되면서는 당당한 인권 운동가가 되었습니다. 그들은 자신의 트라우마에서 벗어나는 것은 물론 다른 피해자들을 돕는 활동가가 되었죠. 일본군 위안부 피해자였다가 인권운동가가 된 대표적인 분이 고 김복동 할머니입니다. 얼마 전에 돌아가셨죠. 이 김복동 할머니는 사제를 출연해서 전시 성폭력 피해 여성들을 위한 평화 나비 기금이라는 것을 만들었습니다. 이 기금은 베트남, 우간다, DR 콩고 등 분쟁에서 성폭력을 당한 여성들을 위해 소중하게 쓰였습니다. 그리고 앞으로도 이런 분쟁 지역 여성들을 돕는 일을 위해서 이 기금이 활용될 것입니다. 심지어 자신의 인권을 짓밟았던 일본이 쓰나미 피해를 입었을 때도 김 할머니는 지원금을 보낼 만큼 숭고한 면모를 보이셨습니다. 저는 이 자리에 계신 모든 분들께 다시 한번 우리 다짐하고 싶습니다. 성폭력 피해 여성들이 30년, 40년이나 지나서야 할머니가 다 되어서야 정언하도록 내버려 두어서는 안 된다고 생각을 합니다. 하루라도 빨리 트라우마를 벗어나도록 손을 내밀어야 한다는 점을 강조하고 싶습니다. 여러분, 지속 가능한 발전은 무엇일까요? 저는 사람 중심, 인권이 존중되는 사회로의 발전, people, 전쟁 없는, 나아가 분쟁을 예방해서 평화가 지속되는 사회, peace, 함께 이익을 나누는 번영, prosperity, 지구의 생태계를 지키는 환경보전, planet이라고 생각을 합니다. 이 4P, people, peace, prosperity, planet은 바로 지속 가능한 발전의 네 가지 핵심 축이기도 합니다. 저는 지속 가능한 발전이 지금까지의 발전 전략과는 확연하게 다른 발전 전략이라고 생각합니다. 새로운 가치, 새로운 접근법입니다. 따라서 기존 사회에서 이익을 누려온 사람보다 사회의 주변 부에 있던 사람들이 새로운 목표, 새로운 고을을 달성하기 위해 달려가게 된다고 생각합니다. 인구의 절반을 차지하면서도 가부장제 사회 주변 부에 머물러 있던 여성들, 특히 개도국에 살고 있는 다수의 가난한 여성들은 지속 가능한 발전 사회의 수혜자이면서 주역이 될 수 있습니다. 그러므로 개도국 발전 전략은 여성들의 역량 강화에 포커스를 둘 때 훨씬 성공할 수 있다고 믿습니다. 유엔 식량농업기구에 따르면은 여성들이 남성들과 평등하게 자원에 접근할 때 농지 경작률은 30%까지 증가하고 이를 통해 1억 5천만 명이 빈곤에서 벗어날 수 있다고 보고하고 있습니다. 세계은행의 2012년 보고서는 어떤 직업에서 여성에 대한 차별이 사라질 경우 생산성이 25% 증가할 수 있다고 설명하고 있습니다. 성평등의 달성 없이는 지속 가능한 발전은 없다. 이러한 선언은 이제 객관적인 통계에 의해서도 뒷받침이 되고 있습니다. 이러한 흐름 속에서 유수의 국제 원조 기관들은 성평등 전략을 수립하고 있으며 제가 최근에 본 걸로는 스웨덴, 캐나다, 호주 등 선진 원조 기관들이 페미니즘에 기반한 ODA 정책 보고서 이런 것을 보고 놀랐습니다. ODA 기관인데 페미니즘에 기반한 전략 보고서, 와 대단하구나 이런 생각을 하고 코이카에게도 좋은 자극제가 되었습니다. 코이카는 지난해 말 성평등 및 여성과 소녀의 역량 강화를 위한 중기 계획을 세웠습니다. 이를 통해서 여성이 가정, 마을, 사회, 국가에서 변혁의 주체가 되도록 역량을 키우려고 합니다. 이는 단순히 말뿐인 여성 역량 강화가 아니라 성평등의 원인인 사회 구조적인 문제를 해소하고 공동체에서 지속 가능한 발전 동력을 확보하는 일이 될 것입니다. 구체적으로 코이카는 우간다 난민 정착촌 여성 경제적 자립 지원 사업, 팔레스타인 제닌 청소년 센터 건립 사업, 코트디부아르 누공 치료 사업 등에서 성공적인 사례를 만들고 있습니다.
이와 함께 아프리카 가나에서 그동안 남성의 영역으로 인식되어 왔던 전자 정비 분야, 좀 첨단적이죠. 이 분야에서 여성 전문가만을 양성하는 직업훈련 학교도 세웠습니다. 혁신가로서의 여성이 가진 잠재력도 이렇게 키워나갈 예정입니다. 존경하는 내외기빈 여러분, 지난해 유엔 총회에서 제가 느낀 소회를 전하면서 마무리를 할까 합니다. 문재인 대통령은 지난해 유엔 총회 연설에서 누구도 소외받지 않는 국제 환경을 만들기 위해 개발 협력 규모를 꾸준히 확대하겠다 하면서 한국 정부는 실질적 성평등 실현을 주요 국정 과제로 추진하고 있다고 강조했습니다. 저도 유엔 총회에 참석하면서 세계 각국에서 온 많은 인사들을 만났습니다. 모두 다 성평등에 대해서 말씀하셨습니다. 그래서 제가 한국에 돌아와서 내가 유엔 총회에 가보니 성평등에 대한 인식이 없는 사람은 시대에 뒤떨어진 사람 취급을 받더라. 지도자는 성평등 인식이 이제는 반드시 있어야겠더라. 이렇게 전했습니다. 더 그냥 한 지금 점잖하게 말했고 제가 한 말은 유엔 가보니까 성평등 얘기하지 않으면 촌놈이더라 이렇게 얘기했습니다. 네, 아 저는 한국에 돌아와 그래서 지속 가능한 사회를 건설하기 위한 가장 강한 에너지는 여성에서 나온다는 저희 믿음도 더욱더 강해졌습니다. 분명한 것은 지속 가능 사회를 향한 여정은 여성의 참여가 있을 때 가능하다는 것입니다. 또한 이를 위해 여성들은 뜻을 같이 하는 모든 사람들과 세력들과 연대해 나가야 한다고는 것입니다. 성평등 실현을 통한 지속 가능한 사회를 위해 한국을 대표해서 코이카도 앞장설 것입니다. 여러분도 이러한 노력에 함께 동참해 주시기를 바랍니다. 감사합니다.
감사합니다. Thank you very much, President Lee. It is my pleasure now to ask the moderator of the session, Joon, professor of the Kwanghee University, to join us on stage to introduce our panelists. A round of applause.
I think all the panelists for this session can come up now and take a seat so that we can start. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Joon. I'm professor at Kyunghee University and former Korean ambassador to the United Nations. Welcome to this plenary session on women's empowerment. In case you are wondering why this panel consists of all these distinguished female speakers, how come the moderator, which is me, is not a woman, I would say nobody is perfect and you need to bear with me. When the United Nations was founded in 1945, the cause of universal human rights was enshrined in its charter. A year later, in 1946, the UN Economic and Social Council, ECOSOC, which I once chaired, created its first subsidiary organs, actually two of them. And one of them was the Commission on the Status of Women, CSW. This shows the importance and urgency the United Nations attached to addressing women's issues, even at this very early stage of its existence. In 1979, the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women, or CEDAW, was adopted in the General Assembly. Today, I think almost all countries in the world are party to this treaty. Ending all forms of discrimination against women is not only a basic human right, but also is critical to accelerating sustainable development. As such, the Sustainable Development Goals, SDGs, adopted in 2015, has gender equality and empowerment of all women and girls as its fifth goal. The SDGs aim to ensure that there is an end to discrimination against women and girls everywhere by reducing inequalities, by fighting sexual violence and exploitation, as well as discrimination in public office. We have seen some progress, for example, as seen in an increase in the number of women in high-ranking positions in the United Nations during Secretary General Ban Ki-moon's term. However, gender inequality still persists worldwide. Ladies and gentlemen, at this plenary session, we have distinguished panelists, actually seven of them, to discuss this critically important issue for human dignity and for a sustainable future for mankind. I will introduce them to you. I will introduce them in their speaking order, not necessarily in the sitting order. Ms. Helen Clark, former administrator of UNDP and former Prime Minister of New Zealand. Thank you. Ms. Armida ALISJAHBANA, Executive Secretary of the UN Economic and Social Commission for Asia and the Pacific, or ASEAN. Ms. Irina BOKOVA, former Director General of the UN Education, Science and Culture Organization, or UNESCO. Ms. KWON Insook, President of Korea Women's Development Institute. Ms. Kati IHAMAKI, Director of Corporate Sustainability of Finnair. Ms. Sabine MACHL, Representative and ASEAN Liaison of UN Women Indonesia. And of course, we have Ms. Lee Mikyung, who gave us an excellent keynote speech, who is president of KOICA. All of these organizations they represent or represented in the past are on the forefront of the international efforts for gender equality and women's empowerment. So it would be great if they can first share their views and insights with us on where we stand and on how we can move forward in achieving SDG 5. We will start with Ms. Helen Clark. You have the floor.
Thank you, Ambassador. Good afternoon, everyone, fellow panelists.
And I'll make my comments around women in public office, because that's what I've devoted most of my life to being, apart from 8 years starting as a university lecturer at the beginning of my career. I was in Parliament 27 and a half years in New Zealand, 9 years as Prime Minister, and then, of course, the 8 years at UNDP, where I got to know the Ambassador and Irina and the former Planning Minister of Indonesia and so many other wonderful people. But I was going to address the great importance of women coming forward to run for public office and to hold high positions, as some of us have been privileged to hold in the multilateral public service system. I think that it's very hard to be what you can't see. And in so many places around the world, women look and girls look at decision makers and they don't see themselves reflected, because there's very few women in a lot of parliaments and there are very few women leaders. If we look globally, women heads of state are still under 8% of the total, and that includes queens, by the way. Women prime ministers, like Prime Minister of New Zealand, are under 6%. So when girls and young women look at this, they think, well, that's not me. I could never be that. And yet they can be. You know, in my country, for more than half the last 21 years, the Prime Minister has been a woman. No other country can claim that, by the way, but we are setting the way on this. And I must give a shout out to Iceland, which had a woman president and two women prime ministers. So they're just about there on the head of government level. But that has made a huge difference in my country, because girls and young women look at these jobs and think, that could be me or my sister or my mother or you know, another woman that I really admire. We have had a woman chief justice for many, many years, and she's just being replaced by another woman. And actually, with a replacement now in the parliament on our party list system, our parliament has just gone without quotas to over 40% women's representation. I'm really proud of that, really proud. So, you know, this is important. It signals that women have a place in decision making. And one, you know, often quotes Hillary Clinton, who said famously, it's not just the right thing to have gender equality, including in these areas, it's the smart thing. Because if you don't have all spheres of society represent decision-making levels, you just don't make very good decisions, because you don't understand adequately the perspectives of the whole population. And there's another old saying that says, no decisions about us without us. Well, a lot of decisions around the world are made with very little women's input at all. And that really does have to change. When I'm asked, you know, what do women bring to decision making, I make a couple of points. One is that all the literature about women in senior positions suggests that for the most part, and there are always exceptions to the rule and we can all think of them, but for the most part, women tend to be more collegial and more consultative, less likely to be top down, you do this, you do that. Women have a role often in their families. They're peacemakers. They're trying to bring people together, trying to sort things out. And I think many women bring these characteristics to leadership. Secondly, to this day, women's lives in general are rather different from men's. Still, disproportionately, women have the major share of bringing up the family, looking after older relatives with disability or illness. And so women tend to be more connected to the state of services. How's the health system working? What about the schools? What about the social services? I'm afraid that in so many cases, men close the door on the family in the morning, they go off to work, they come home at night, and someone's done all those interactions with the services, and it's usually the woman and the family. So women are bringing different life experiences. It's been very interesting to me reading so much now about Speaker Nancy Pelosi to see how much she is drawing on being a mother of five children and what she learned from that. And now also having a role, obviously, in the upbringing of her grandchildren. So there's just different perspectives and experiences that, that women bring. My understanding of the literature around what happens when women go into parliaments in greater numbers is that issues which didn't used to get addressed get addressed. An example is sometimes given of Costa Rica, where when the numbers started to swing, issues like support for the single parent with children, generally a woman, were raised. In Rwanda, which has the highest representation of women in parliament anywhere in the world, those women take up issues which are very important to women, which have been neglected. And I look back on my time as a decision maker with huge pride on some of the things I was able to do. I introduced the first nationwide screening program for cervical cancer when I was a Minister of Health, going back 30 years ago. The first screening program for breast cancer. I also intervened with legislation to make midwifery an autonomous profession, because up until that time in New Zealand, a midwife had always had to have a doctor tick off her decisions. Doctor never did any work, he just ticked off that she'd done the right thing. We empowered the midwives to be an autonomous profession, which was extremely important. And then there were quite major moves when I was Prime Minister, because it wasn't only me, I also had a body of women ministers who cared about these things, and we took the men along with us to improve the parental leave when small children were born, to improve access and funding for early childhood care and education. So parents had a genuine choice about whether to return to work when their children were small. So there are, you know, many things which can happen when women come into positions of power and start to address issues which haven't been effectively addressed. Now, how to make it happen, how to bring change. I always think back to 2012 and the Commission on the Status of Women, and in the margins, UNDP held a side event. And at that side event, I released a handbook on growing political participation of women. And it was based on case studies of best practice, what worked around the world. And it focused on three things. First, selection. And this is really aimed at political parties. Political parties have to go out of their way to make sure that they recruit women and enable them to stand for parliaments and other bodies in their countries in a position where they can win. That's the first thing. You have to change the minds and hearts of political parties. Secondly, women need support for their campaigns. And the reality is around the world, women don't have the same wealthy networks as men have. Old girls' networks are not as wealthy as old boys' networks. So women need financial support. And in many countries, they also need physical security support, because where women are going into things which they haven't done so much before, they can often face outright threats to their personal security. And then post-election, our guidebook advocated there needs to be support for the women's caucuses, and UNDP and UN Women around the world have done a lot of that sort of work of supporting the women across parties to work together to be effective and get the skills for that. I should say that the type of political system a country has will also have an impact on the representation of women in parliaments. In New Zealand, we struggled away with a first-past-the-post system, like the American House of Representatives and the British Parliament. And by 1996, we'd got up to 20% women. When we changed to proportional representation, it immediately went to 30%, because parties had to produce lists. And if they produced lists that had all men on them, what on earth would persuade women to vote for them? The parties got the message fairly quickly, and that has helped us get up to over the 40% now. But I do believe that quotas must be considered when progress is too slow. You know, I see some countries really struggling to get women elected. Take, for example, Papua New Guinea. Years ago, we were working, when I was at UNDP, with Papua New Guinea's only woman Member of Parliament and only woman Cabinet Minister, Dame Carol Kidu, on a quota system for women. She couldn't get it through.
I think the next election there were 3 women elected. Now, with more recent elections, there are no women in the Papua New Guinea parliament. And this is a country of over 5 million people where there's no women in the parliament. This is really just not acceptable. And I hope that, you know, the UN team will continue to support the women and civil society there to try to make a change for that. Quotas do work. They do bring significant numbers of women into parliaments quickly. My last point would be, we can do a lot to change systems, put support in place, but women also need to have the self-belief and the confidence to step forward to run. And often you see women pretty turned off politics. They say, oh, that's not very nice. Oh, you know, it's too tough, it's too rough. Hey, it is often all of those things, but you're never going to change it unless you go in and build the alliances and networks which will make it possible. So I think, you know, as we talk about SDG 5 and gender equality, there are so many aspects of it that are important, are all important. But it does help to have more women decision makers who will push these issues along at the national level. And nothing much will happen on SDGs anywhere unless decision makers, country by country, region by region, municipality by municipality, think it's important. And they're much more likely to think it's important if women are there in good numbers and hopefully at parity in decision making circles. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Clark. I think indeed a lot of people would agree that you are a trailblazer when it comes to women's empowerment in politics and in global governance. By the way, I would like to advise the audience that after the round, we will open the floor and you might ask questions as long as time allows. So you might as well prepare some questions now. And then next we will have Ms. Armida ALISJAHBANA, who is Executive Secretary of the UNESCAP. Please, Alice.
Thank you very much, Ambassador Joon. It's a great honor and pleasure for me to have this opportunity to share with you our thoughts on advancing this women empowerment, especially in our region, Asia Pacific. And I also like very much the title of this session, which is Get Back to Basics. Yeah. So if I may, I would like to start with the Get Back to Basic, but within the context of our region, Asia Pacific. ROK is certainly in Asia Pacific region. Yeah. If you follow the data, the development, especially socio-economic development of our region, Asia Pacific, certainly, unarguably, Asia Pacific as a region, as a whole, has progressed tremendously, especially in the front of socio-economic development. Yeah. So, or in other words, the society in many countries in the region has been transformed. Certainly, we would like to maintain the momentum for every country in the region. So the question is, what does it take to have a transformed and resilient society? Because a transformed and resilient society, we believe, not only me, I think everybody would concur, is the foundation, lies at the foundation of a transform, a socio-economic development. So a transform and resilient society in which socio-economic development, especially maybe my bias, social development is the key or the heart. This is where we can refer or we can also align to the topic of this session, which is let's get to the basics. So in terms of women, let me share. At UNESCAP, my office and my colleagues, last year we had this theme topic that we have, which is because of this issue, inequality. Everybody is concerned about inequality. But what we do, or we did, is a slightly different angle, which is we look more deeply, more carefully at this issue of inequality of opportunity. Yeah. So in terms of opportunity of what? Opportunity in terms of education, in terms of health, and also in terms of social security. So those three, yeah, which are, of course, we know these are the basics. Yeah. And how about for women? For women, of course, the data shows, yeah, the study shows that, of course, women are at a disadvantage, yeah, in terms of equality of opportunity in education, health, and social security. Again, yeah, we also know that progress have been made, yeah, but for especially for the poorest, let's say 20% poorest, yeah, and women, they are very much at a disadvantage. Rural areas, remote areas. Yeah, that's one. In all categories of education indicators, health-related indicators, as well as social security-related coverage. Yeah. Maybe we can say it. Yeah, on average. Yeah. Again, of course, yeah, there are certain countries in our region already. They do not have this kind of problem anymore. Yeah? But for the developing countries in our region, these are the problems. Yeah? So that's one. The basics, yeah? The basics, especially for the poorer households, especially for the women. Yeah? Why is this important? Yeah, because again, yeah, when we see from the literature, from the daily observation, daily, you know, what we know, yeah, experiences, this is the key. Yeah? Household to go out of poverty, yeah, to escape poverty, these are the key, these three basics. And second, yeah, I think, again, yeah, we are not going to be able to go far. Yeah? Again, if we have the basics, that's very good, but we would not be able to go very far if we do not develop or have the second element, which is sustainable livelihood. Yeah, sustainable livelihood is at the core. Yeah? Whether it's poverty reduction, and of course for a transform socio-economic development, a transform society. So the second pillar, second element is sustainable livelihood. Again, women plays a very important or key role in this case. Yeah. Women, especially poor household, yeah, if they have this livelihood, they can help the family. They can have their children go to school, yeah, no dropout. They can give the family, the children, sufficient out-of-pocket expenses, yeah, for the school. Healthcare, yeah, although healthcare, the basic ones may be covered by the government, but again, yeah, that is out-of-pocket expenses. And they can provide, yeah, help the families, yeah, with all the necessaries, yeah. So again, this sustainable life is very important. And if we see again the data, not very encouraging. Yeah. Many women, especially from the poor household, of course, yeah, if they work, they work oftentimes in not very good working conditions, yeah, hardly being paid, yeah, and things like that, yeah. So based on these two, what can we do? Yeah, of course, many initiatives are already there. Yeah, but share also just briefly what we facilitate. Yeah, several countries in the region, because we are a regional commission. Yeah, so therefore we work in several countries. One example, yeah, what we've been doing the past few years to help on this women empowerment agenda, and also livelihood and the basic, yeah, the basics, but especially on the livelihood is by way how also to facilitate empowered women for this, their work, yeah, entrepreneurship. But again, entrepreneurship, not only entrepreneurship as such, yeah, but how to leverage more. Yeah? I think in the previous session already, yeah, there's some discussion. Some also already alluded in that direction, but especially for entrepreneurship, using this now, yeah, this this technology, the IT, ICT, and then the fintech and so on and so forth. I come from Indonesia, yeah. I come from Indonesia, this middle income country, emerging country. This is a very big thing. Women entrepreneurs springing out, yeah. With this fintech, you know, IT, ICT, they sell through their Instagram, Facebook, everything, yeah? And it facilitates, yeah? It facilitates. So the question is how we whether it's the regional commission, UN, World Bank, everybody can, facilitate more, yeah? Facilitate more, but in a more systematic manner. Yeah, so one last note that I would like also to share, because we are doing this, we as a regional commission, we also have regional center, regional institution. One is here in Incheon, which is on IT, ICT, and they are doing exactly that. Yeah, so they have training programs on IT, ICT to help women entrepreneurs, not in one country, but in, I think, it's already 6 countries across the region, yeah, by way of TOT, or training of trainers. We hope by this kind of example, concrete work, yeah, that we can facilitate the empowerment of women in a concrete way. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ibu Armida. Actually, her organization, UNESCAP, has had 3 consecutive female executive secretaries from Norlin Hazer, Shamshad Akhtar, and Ibu Armida, which might serve as a disproof of the common misperception that Asian women are not as active as those in other regions. The next is Ms. Irina BOKOVA, former Director General of UNESCO. Please, Irina.
Thank you very much, Joon. Thank you very much, dear friend and colleague from Kyung University, because I'm also there, an honorary professor. I'm very excited to be here again, like last year, for this GEEF, a very important forum. Both in my capacity as a former Director General of UNESCO, but also as a member of the Ban Ki-moon Center for Global Citizens, who is the co-sponsor of this important event. And I was particularly this morning moved by the speech right now, the introductory speech of Mrs. Lee. And I would like really to pay tribute once again to your vision and to what KOICA is doing for the development in so many countries in the world. And of course, most particularly, on your focus on women, on women's empowerment, on ending violence against women, on supporting governments, capacity building, and the international organizations in this so very important ambition. And once again, to mention the leadership of the United Nations. Of course, I could mention that it was under the tenure of Mr. Ban Ki-moon, the Secretary General, when the United Nations Women was created in 2012. Before that, this agenda was dispersed among other entities which had their impact, but they were not that much focused, and I'm so happy that we have also here United Nations Women with us, and we all have been working in order to see how our separate responsibilities within the United Nations system, we can work together for this common goal. And when we are speaking about the leadership of the United Nations, my personal experience as a young diplomat in the 80s, I was at the conference in Copenhagen, in the 1980, then 85 in Nairobi, within the United Nations decade, then of course the landmark conference in Beijing in 95. And I would say that without this leadership, I believe, of the United Nations, we wouldn't have seen such a growing mobilization around this so important agenda. And I think we all, women leaders in the United Nations and globally, I would say, have a very particular responsibility for this agenda. I have taken very seriously when I was elected in 2009, so that this priority of gender equality and women's empowerment, and I would like immediately to say gender equality and women's empowerment, because I believe the two get together. We may have, in many circumstances, equality of women in education, legal, in political life and others, but without empowering women, without creating this important ecosystem so that they're empowered, we were not going to see the progress that we want to see. And this goal number five, it is so much cross-cutting. When I say that I took very seriously this responsibility, it means that if we do something at UNESCO on education, it should be with a particular focus on girls' education. And this is where we launched with the UNFPA and also with the UN Women in 2015, a particular, and with the support of KOICA later that joined us, a very important initiative on empowering adolescent girls. Because this is where, in adolescent girls, when they pass into the puberty, when they pass in adolescence, where the very, I would say, critical, very important stage of their lives is, in order for them to be further on members of their societies. And I remember once I went 2 years ago, I went to Afghanistan. I went and I met, because UNESCO had at that time one of the biggest literacy programs in Afghanistan, and I went to see young women who were participating in this program. And I asked them from a village near Kabul, and I asked them, what did you learn? Why this is so important? And for me, stunningly, I received three answers that exactly prove what we are talking here today about this cross-cutting importance of goal number five. The first one was telling me, I learned about hygiene. Now I know how I can better take care of my children and my family. Before that, I didn't know anything. I couldn't even read what is on the box or on the bottle of a medicine that I had to give to my children. Hence the importance of the debate about women and health that we had this morning. The second one stunningly also said, I learned about nature. I didn't know about nature. I didn't know how important it is and what difference it makes also for us, because I have never went away from my small village. And the third one was saying, now I can go to the market and I can get better deals when I negotiated the prices on the market. It may be a very simple thing, but it is exactly about the economy, the economic empowerment of women. So I want to say that this leadership of the United Nations, we have had enormous strides. But, and here but comes into the picture. The published, the World Economic Forum's report on gender gap, which was published in 2017, shows that the gender gap unfortunately increases. And the Economic Forum, they benchmark 144 countries in the three main areas. This is the political participation, the access and the opportunities in health and education, and the third is the economic empowerment of women. So this gender gap, unfortunately, is increasing. And I remember when I was member, we started in 2012 a broadband commission for digital development, and with Helen we were sitting there. It was a joint initiative between UNESCO and the International Telecommunication Union, and we set a working group there on gender. At some point, I think Helen chaired it. The last meeting in 2017, I chaired a report that we published. And we once again identified that the digital divide, gender digital divide, unfortunately, once again, is increasing. We have to know that out of 3.5 billion people that do not have access nowadays in digital, new technology area, they do not have access to internet, the vast majority of them are women. So this is once again to show that it is a very complex issue that we have to tackle from all different sides to empower women to do what we want them to do. Because if women are involved into economic life of the planet, according to McKinsey's report, another benchmark report that they published in 2015, where we were adopting the Agenda 2030, if women are there, they said that by 2025, the global GDP will increase by 12 billion or 11%. You can imagine what kind of development, prosperity, social cohesion, social inclusion there will be for so many countries. So I do believe, like KOICA is doing, to support gender budgeting into different countries or what is said, the feminist agenda, I think it is very important. And last but not least, and I know that United Nations Women is working so hard on it, we also have to involve and to educate men. We have to show them the benefits of families, of societies, of communities. We have to show them that we say we are feminists or we are defending this agenda. This is not against men. We are not against them. We want to partner with them because we think that it is the best agenda for society. It's a societal issue. It is not just an issue of social justice, of historic justice. Yes, it is. I agree, it is. But it is one of the best ways to achieve this cohesion and this prosperity of a society, of communities, and of the family. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Irina. As you might recall, Irina was, a few years back, she was one of the strongest candidates for UN Secretary General.
With Helen.
The two of us.
So the two of us are sitting here.
I just passed her because I did.
Yes, sorry, I interrupted you.
And, I was Korean ambassador that time, so I was one of the ambassadors who met all the candidates who spoke in front of us. And many of us felt that because there were more female candidates than male, many of us felt that finally we are going to have a woman secretary general for the first time in the history of the United Nations. But, Mr. Guterres is not a woman. That might be his only shortcoming, like myself. But as I said, nobody's perfect. And Mr. Guterres is not bad. He's an excellent Secretary General. Anyway, we move on. And we have Ms. Kwon Insook, President of the Korea Women's Development Institute. You have the floor, madam.
Good afternoon. Thank you for inviting me to this important event, and it is really my honor to be participating at this forum with these prominent gender experts and leaders around the world. Before I begin, I would like to introduce my institute shortly. KWDI is a government think tank on gender and family issues policy under the Prime Minister's Office of South Korea. It was founded in 1983. We have actively been engaged in all aspects of gender issues within and outside of Korea. Today, I would like to speak to you about the Me Too movement that has shaken the whole South Korean society since last year. Let me begin with the Me Too case of Seo Ji-hyun, a female prosecutor in Korea. In January 2018, Seo Ji-hyun appeared on TV to reveal that she was sexually harassed by a senior prosecutor. Another case came soon after. In March 2018, Kim Ji-eun appeared in a news interview and revealed that her boss left her from 2017. Her boss was An Hee-jung, who was then provincial governor and prominent presidential candidate in Korea. She also claimed that he sexually harassed her on several occasions. After this, Kim filed a lawsuit against An, but An was acquitted of sexual assault charges in August 2018. The court did not recognize that there was an abuse of authority, and this enraged many women in South Korea, claiming that women have no state in this country. This case went to appeals court and actually 2 weeks ago, this year, An was sentenced to 3.5 years in prison on charges of sexually abusing his secretary. This ruling is significant in that it recognized abuse of authority, which does not necessarily have to be forceful and visible. This case will be able to set a new standard against sexual violence in Korean society. These two cases came as a shock to Korean society and ignited the Me Too movement in Korea. Women have since come forward with accusations of sexual abuse from various sectors of Korean society, such as entertainment and sports. School Me Too also started to increase in numbers. Middle and high school girls openly condemned sexual abuse and harassment by their teachers. At the start of 2019, South Korea is once more embroiled in the Me Too of a short track Olympic gold medalist who disclosed being constantly beaten and raped by her coach. The seriousness of such incidents soon prompted the public supporting with hashtag Me Too and with you. Women in Korea took to streets voicing up their demands to eliminate sexual harassment and violence. Not only celebrities or prominent women figures, but ordinary women were no longer afraid to tell their stories in public in rallies. Their willingness to speak and audacious testimonies have come across as a surprise to the public and to the government. Public awareness on secondary victimization also has increased. According to a survey conducted by KWDI, our organization, in 2019, 8 out of 10 women support Me Too movement. Another survey by KWDI showed that 64% of men of South Korea support the Me Too movement. We can think about the significance of Me Too movement in South Korea in a couple of ways. First, Me Too movement in Korea was not a one-time event, but a wave that started from women of all sectors and ages, standing on the line of South Korea's long-time women's movement against sexual violence. In Korea, efforts to prevent gender-based violence was initiated by women's NGOs from the early 1990s. Women's groups from that time already defined gender-based violence as a structural problem resulting from unequal gender relations and patriarchy. Mikyung was one of the women's movement, the leaders of the women's movement at the time. The current Me Too movement cuts across the timeline as it stands on continuum of such efforts. Second, this time, we are more focusing on sexual violence within the working relationship. The Me Too movement gives a new attention to the problems of gender inequality in the labor sector. According to OECD statistics, in South Korea, women earn only 63% of what men earn. It is the lowest level among OECD countries. In addition, women occupy only 33% voting members in the corporate sector. According to a survey by KWDI, 44.2% of women is said to have experienced sexual discrimination in recruitment process. The unequal gender power relations in the workplace brings about discriminations and harassment against women. As sexual violence takes place in this unbalanced power structure, currently, South Korea is facing many social problems, including issues such as low birth rate and gender inequalities. Gender inequality in labor sector endangers the sustainability of the South Korean society as a whole. In Korea, gender inequality is becoming a major issue in society, and the younger generations are becoming more aware of this problem. According to a survey conducted by KWDI last year, 5 out of 10 young women in their 20s claim themselves as feminist. Young men in Korea are also increasingly aware of gender inequality issues in society. Me Too in Korea is unique in that it is not a simple debate of violence is a bad thing. Now the debate is not on whether or not to punish the perpetrator, but more on changing the structure that keeps reproducing this kind of violence. There is a shared understanding that gender inequality within the organization and hierarchical structure in society is the fundamental cause. As I have mentioned before, support from men on Me Too movement is not low. And we can see that men too want to bring about changes to this rigid and hierarchical culture, along with the big wave of Me Too movement. In this sense, Me Too movement started a transformative change towards a society where equality and sustainability is ensured. I hope that this dialogue would provide a great opportunity for sharing similar experiences you might have in your own country. I also wish that this forum would provide a platform for further strengthening our partnership based on our common goals of eradicating gender-based violence in most transformative way. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Kwon. The organization she's heading, KWDI, has a long and distinguished track record in Korea in advocating and promoting women's rights. And Ms. Kwon herself is a very widely respected human rights activist. We would like to hear the voice of the corporate sector, which is very important for gender equality. So we now have Ms. Kati, Director of Corporate Sustainability of Finnair. You have the floor.
Thank you. I will have a couple of slides to help present the case of Finnair. And first of all, I'm very happy to be here with these distinguished guests and speakers. Happy to bring the voice of the corporates and hopefully also from the aviation sector and Finland. And let me start with the real story. I have 4 boys and and last time when we had the presidential elections, my boys asked, can men also be presidents? Because for whole of their lifetime, there had been a women president in Finland. So they were surprised. So nowadays they've learned that also we can have a man as a president, but also a man as a president who is advancing girls' rights and women's rights. That's happening now in Finland. But then for the corporate life, I just wanted to show where I come from. Finland, Finnair is the Finnish carrier, and we specialize in the traffic between Europe and Asia. We have a little bit over 6,000 people working for us. And Finnair does cooperate with lots of different organizations, also UN organizations, to advance sustainability, not only taking the climate action, of course, which is important for the sector as ours. We try to diminish the environmental footprint, but also advance the social and economical well-being. We have a strategy where people are in the center. And these four cornerstones here also represent our views about the sustainability, also our views about the gender equality. The most important thing for us is the people experience. How the personnel of Finnair, do they feel equal? Do they feel safe working for a company like ours? Also, same applies for the customer experience. We do want to treat equally our customers all around the world. So equal treatment, non-discrimination of customers is important, as well as transformation. In this rapidly changing world, we also need education for our current workers, but also we want to achieve education all around the world by helping, for instance, UNICEF in the programs like educational programs around the world, especially in Asia. So we have, with UNICEF, we have a program called Schools for Asia. That's also a program where we want to bring their course forward during their flights that people might take, so we are able to also showcase the UNICEF work in our network, but also that will help us to hopefully advance the education, especially in the societies where we operate. And then there is issue of growth. Of course, there's a limit to the growth that aviation can achieve in the world, where we need to reduce our emissions. This is where we try to also work together with the other players of the industry, diminishing the environmental footprint while growing. Our values of the company also nourish the sustainability as well as equality. We want our own people to be courageous, to take things forward. We want them to be committed to care, caring for each other, caring for the customers, caring for the societies. And we want to do this in a simplistic way so that our message gets through. Finnair is committed for cleaner. Being an airline, you cannot really be clean. You have to be cleaner, caring and collaborative future. Also, for the aviation sector, Finnair is an active player. We are actually bigger than our sizes. And we did contribute to the mapping of all the SDGs for the aviation sector. I think aviation is the first sector where all the SDGs were mapped to our operation. What can we achieve? How can we help the SDGs to go forward? And there is also the case of gender equality, number 5. And these were the figures that were taken out of that global mapping of the aviation sector. This include not only the airlines, but also the airports and the air navigation services. So as you see, there are women working for airlines, but there is still lots to do. And what we try to achieve together with the other players in the sector, we try to support the women in tech, especially, like mentioned here before. There's still things to do in this sector, trying to get more women working for the aviation sector and advance the technology. But when it comes to the Finnair and equality, most of the people working for Finnair are women. But of course, there are differences. Most of the people working for the customer service jobs are women, but we miss women in
as pilots, we miss women in the engineering. That's why we try to advance this by taking the issue. We go to schools, we go to universities, tell also women that you could be a pilot, you can choose the engineering as your main topic, and there will be jobs for you provided also in the sector. We did a couple of flights with all female pilot crew, all female panel, as said, where the whole crew of the flight was female. Then when it comes to our board of directors, we have women there. We also, almost half of our executive board is women. We of course try to advance and get these numbers even higher whenever possible, but we also value other type of diversity, not only the gender diversity, but also people from with different educational backgrounds, people with different age. So diversity for us means all these things, not only the gender diversity or equality. We were the first Finnish company to sign women's empowerment principles, and I think that is important to show other businesses that these things matter. It is important to support women's empowerment also in the corporate side. Then with the equality and non-discrimination plan is published, that's also required already by Finnish government, but we as a company try to advance and get more companies to publish their plan. How can we advance equality, non-discrimination, inclusion in our operations, but also towards the customers? We do provide, one of the things that we wrote down in the plan is to support flexible working hours, both for women and men. So you don't have to stay at home if you don't want to when you get family, when you have children. We support flexible working hours for people with children and families. Also, we, for instance, last summer offered the possibility for people to take their children to summer, so-called summer camp, offered by the company, so that in the summertime also we have equal opportunities for men and women to work, even if they have a family. So these are the little things that we do. But on top of that, in that equality plan, we do publish the salary levels in every level of the company. And I think that is very important, the transparency, so that we can see what's going on in the company. We also want to be transparent in our recruitment process, so that either gender is not chosen over the other, but there are equal opportunities for everybody in recruitment process, also in training opportunities provided by the company. And also when it comes to the SDGs, there is a commitment 2050, which is the Finnish commitment, Finnish authorities' commitment for sustainable development, advancing sustainable development goals in Finland. Finnair did the commitment for advancing equal rights, non-discrimination and diversity. We could have done this for the climate, because that's obvious that being an airline, you have to work for the climate. But this is something that we do already as an industry. So we wanted to do the commitment for non-discrimination and equality, because I think then the voice is heard also by the other companies and the Finnish society. Then we do work with lots of different companies. We don't call this charity or philanthropy. This is cooperation with the organizations. We can learn from the organizations. We can learn from the UN Women, for instance. And what we've learned is the way to advance this globally to societies, to develop the societies, the best thing is to support women and girls. That's the way to advance social development in the country, support women and girls. That's what we've been able to do through our work with UNICEF, schooling the children, especially in Asia, but also through the work with UN Women and Women's Empowerment Principle. And one more cooperation partner that I want to bring forward is the CMI, which is the Crisis Management Initiative. And last autumn, they had a campaign which Finnair supported as well. And there was this joke. What does this thing have in common? There's a ballpoint pen, notebook, bottle of water, pocket of flowers, and middle-aged man. What do these things have in common? They all are seated in the peace negotiating table, but the women are missing. There are only 8% of women who are participating in the peace processes around the world. And this is also something that we wanted to bring forward. We need women in all the negotiations, in all the activities in the societies in order to support the sustainable development. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Kati. I can see your son's perspective. My late mother was a college professor throughout her life. And when I was a kid, a working mom was very rare in Korea. So one day I was chatting with my friends when I was very young, and one of them was saying, like, you know, when you go home, when mom is not there, you really feel lousy, which is probably rare. So all others agreed. And then I didn't know what to say because my mother is always not at home when I go home. So I realized that I only have a working mom and all others have always their mother at home. Anyway. Last but not least, we have the voice of UN Women, an organization which was created during Secretary Ban Ki-moon's time. And we have Ms. Sabine MACHL, representative and ASEAN liaison of UN Women Indonesia. You have the floor.
Thank you very much. And I would like to also present the greetings from my executive director. Thanks to the president of KOICA, Madam Lee. You have seen her in the pictures before when there was a memorandum signed with KOICA and UNFPA and UN Women. So unfortunately, she could not come, but I should pass on the greetings to the chief. Before I start talking in particular on two issues, which is about the elimination of violence against women and girls, as well as how we include more men in our work, I also wanted to draw the attention to you that UN Women last year did a report which was called Turning Promises into Actions. And actually, a lot of issues that you've just heard here from the distinguished panel are also featured in this report because it goes through all the 17 sustainable development goals and looks at what is happening with the indicators and how do we progressing. And one conclusion is that we need to really accelerate the work in this particular area, that we really need to join forces and make it faster, because you have seen that some people have said it will take between 100 and 200 years if we continue at the pace that we are currently in increasing gender parity and gender equality. So maybe this report, I think, is very, very interesting to look into more of the details. Having said that, I wanted to say also that it was really good to hear the experience from Korea as well. I think the issues of violence are so important. We cannot reach the sustainable development goals if we do not eliminate the violence against women and girls. One in three is simply too many, and this has not changed over the years, and I think this is something that we really need to address. I could have put probably all the 17 goals there, but just those to illustrate of how much it actually costs society. It would be so much better if we can prevent it from occurring in the very first place. If you're just looking maybe at women's economic empowerment, and we've just heard from the corporate sector, and I think Finnair is also a signatory of the Women's Empowerment Principles. These are 7 principles for the private sector, which were created back in 2010 between UN Women and the Global Compact. And one of these principles also talks about the health of women, their right of freedom from violence, and their safety. So also for the corporate sector, I think this is very important to have in mind, that there is always this link to the economic empowerment, that we need to have the safety there. On migration, I wanted to mention a program that we are currently carrying out in all the 10 ASEAN member states. It is called Safe and Fair, and it comes under the Spotlight Initiative together with the European Union. where we together with the ILO are looking into safe and fair migration of female migrant workers. So from a perspective of decent work, but also not to be exposed to violence throughout the migration cycle and what to do if it happens. National planning and budgeting is another very important part. It was already mentioned here. It is something for governments to really consider when the national plans are done, that there is also enough attention being paid, that there is appropriate funding for actually addressing violence against women and girls. The good news is that there is definitely a way forward and there are opportunities of how we can eradicate this and really have every girl and every woman also live a life free from violence. Clustering this around the three topics, very important is definitely an enabling legislative and policy environment. This is something that we are working with, not only alone, but with many others in the UN family. Very, very important for all states also to pay a lot of attention to this. Strengthening frameworks, also the knowledge and the capacity to coordinate the protection of women, also migrant workers, as I said earlier, in this ASEAN program, for example. ASEAN has recently also issued guidance for all the member states of how to better collect data. And Dr. Natalia from UNFPA was underlining the importance of data in this respect, because this can help us also for advocacy work in this area. So the ASEAN member states actually have this guidance of how to better collect and analyze the prevalence data, administrative data, as well as also the costing data. Because this is usually always a big shock for many of the parliamentarians when we see how much it actually costs an economy if we do not tackle this issue. Essential services is another example where the United Nations work together. Together with UNFPA, WHO, UNDP, and UNODC, we in UN Women have the essential services package, which also aims to provide a greater access to really coordinated set of essential and quality multisectoral services for all the women and girls who have experienced violence. It is something that seeks to fill the gap of what we are deciding at the international level, but then also what is really happening at the country level. And it provides evidence-based technical assistance and policy guidance to really help the implementation at the country level. And then the last basket, which is about social norm change. This is also very, very important and has been mentioned by many speakers before already. There are important tools available in the education. For example, the Changemakers tool, which is a toolkit for young people to facilitate some peer-to-peer discussions on gender equality, on violence against women, and also on healthy relationships. How we connect with respect is also very important to learn from a very young age. And then last but not least, also the campaigns. His Excellency Ban Ki-moon actually launched two very important campaigns. One was the UNITE campaign, where the entire UN comes together to prevent and to eliminate gender-based violence through our joint programming and also to do joint advocacy at the different levels, regional level, country levels, and sometimes also at the provincial and district and even village level. And then the He for She platform, which was launched back in 2014 by Mr. Ban Ki-moon, the Executive Director of UN Women, and also Mrs. Emma Watson, who is a UN Women Goodwill Ambassador. And I think Mrs. Bukova was also present at the launch of the He for She campaign. I don't know if you've heard about it, but this is a very, has really had a very big effect. We had more than 2 billion conversations on the social media about He for She, in all directions, but it was very important that the issue is coming up of how we have men also stand up for gender equality, how they can become also agents for change and promote a positive masculinity. So this was something which was very, very important, we believe, to also roll out and to show the solidarity with the women's movement. On my last slide here, you see some of them. And I think for the four boys, he is a He for She champion, the male president of Finland, he's also one of them. On the pictures, as you can see, here in Asia Pacific, we have also two heads of states. We have President Jokowi from Indonesia, the country I currently serve in, and also Prime Minister Abe in Japan. And you see a number of others. There is people from the corporate level. We also have impact champions from the academia, and then the heads of state. And we very much hope that really together, all of us can give an expiry date, as our ED always says, to gender inequality. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Sabina. As you have kindly explained to us, I think the establishment of UN Women was truly a very important landmark in the UN's efforts to promote gender equality. So now we have heard all the panelists. We have about 20 minutes left. So I would like to open the floor and those in the gallery might want to ask questions or make comments. If you are asking questions to any of the panelists, you can either address one panelist specifically, or you can just ask generally, and any of them might answer. Okay, the lady in the middle. Yeah.
Thank you so much. I'm Elena Kamaya, a PhD student from Moscow Higher School of Economics, Russia. And first of all, I would like to thank all the panelists and the moderator for all the contribution that you made today to the women empowerment. I have a very, I would say, provocative question to all the panelists. As you said, Mr. Ujun, there was a big contribution made since the day the UN started. But still, it's 2019, yes, 19. And still, despite so many things have been made for women empowerment, we still have to tackle some very bad consequences like pay gap, glass ceiling, and all the bad things that's still being done, even to the women in the powerful positions. And even today, during the panelists' discussion, I heard some expressions that were alarming in terms of this discussion. Like, for example, we have to join forces. We aren't against men, we want to partner with them. And judging from other words, I would say it still sounds like a standoff between men and women, like we have to fight, like we have to negotiate, like it's still some war, and we are joining forces and finding allies and try to drag these allies to parliament and to all other high-ranking positions to fight more effectively. So I wonder when this perception of women as fighting some war, like this against slavery, for example, would end, when there would be no question, like, doesn't matter who this person is, a man or a woman, all that matters is just he or she earned this place on the merit-based system, and we live in a world of true gender equality. When do you think this standoff, even in today's discussions, would be completely eliminated? Thank you so much.
Thank you. That's an excellent question. We will collect a few more questions and get back to the audience, to the panelists, I mean. We will move to the right side here.
Thank you very much. My name is Joel Petsoneva. I'm a graduate student here at Yonsei Graduate School of International Studies. I would like to address this question specifically to Prime Minister Clark. I'm from Sweden, which is a quite small country. We are the first country that ever, I should say, not we, because I'm not in the government, but my country is the first to promote a feminist foreign policy. We also have, of course, the example of New Zealand, of Finland, Rwanda was also mentioned. So it seems to me that the countries that are kind of trailblazing the, women's rights in, internationally are rather small countries. So my question is, how should these small countries with very limited resources use those resources with regards to their foreign policy in order to influence greater, like bigger countries with more resources to further the cause of women's rights? Thank you very much.
Thank you. Actually, I was going to recognize the lady here, but it's okay. Gender balance.
Hello, thank you so much for taking my question, and thank you for being here today. My name is Lindsay Posmanek. I am a master's international human rights student from the Joseph Corbell School of International Studies in the United States. My question for you today is, what book do you recommend that has had a significant impact on your approach to gender equality? Thank you.
Okay. You are not addressing that question to any specific panelist or in general. Great, thank you. And we will move there. Perhaps a man? Yeah, you have the floor.
First of all, I would like to say good afternoon to our respective panelists for being here today. And my name is Rani Ponrich, I'm from Cambodia. And here's the question, you know, in Asia, if we look at the political institution, we can see that the majority of the people there are mostly men. And therefore, how could we ensure that the political decision and resolution would also benefit both men and women? The next question is that, what action should we take in order to encourage and to encourage women to join and be active in politics. Thank you.
Your question is what action should be taken to encourage women to get into politics? It sounds like women are reluctant to. Would you give him microphone again?
What I mean by that is that, you know, if you look at the number of women inside the National Assembly in Cambodia, only 20% of the people there are women. And so the question is that how could we encourage women to be to join the parliament and be active in there? Okay. To increase the number of them inside the national parliament. Thank you.
Okay, I will take one more question and we will get back to the panelists. In the middle, maybe this lady.
Hello, my name is Jung Im-che from World Traditional Cultural Play Association. I can speak English. I'm very many courage. Yes, I have question of everyone or Panel. Yes.
Yeah, you might ask your question in Korean as well. We have a translator, so if
네.
you liked, you can ask.
아, 네, 감사합니다. 여기 계신 모든 분들하고 이제 오셔서 말씀해주신 분들께 이제 질문을 해드리고 싶은데 저희 세계 전통 문화 놀이 협회에서 이제 여성분들을 위해서 사업을 준비를 했습니다. 가정 행복이라는 건데 이거에 대한 시작이 이제 어머니들로부터 시작한다라는 걸로 진행을 하려고 합니다. 근데 이게 많은 사람들의 관심도 필요한데 말씀해 주셔서 설명을 해 주셔서 진짜 오늘 너무 큰 도움을 많이 받았고요. 그래서 혹시나 나중에 진짜 이런 행사들이 지금 너무 작지만 행사가 세계적으로 커지고 규모적으로 커질 때 관심을 가져줄 수 있는지, 그리고 여기 계신 분들도 정말 이 여성 인권을 더 복돋기 위해서 오셨잖아요. 그래서 이런 행사를 할 때 관심을 가져주시고 또한 함께 행사에 참여해 주시고 할 수 있는지에 대해서 물어보고 싶습니다. 네, 너무 쉬운 질문이었죠. 네.
I think her question is about traditional play and games because she is representing an organization devoted to traditional culture, playing and games, and she is asking you whether because role of mother is important in a family. So in that regard, when we talk about gender equality, how they can have more attention to this traditional, to the function of traditional entertainment in family. I think that's basically what she means. Anyway, I will get back to the panelists. Maybe we can have another round, probably. Time will allow one more round. But at this point, I would like to get back to the panelists. We will just go from Ms. Lee Mikyung in the order of their seating. If you don't have any comments, you can just pass.
Yes, 네, 저는 캄보디아에서 오신 방청객의 질문에 답변을 하는 게 좋겠다 생각합니다. 어떻게 여성들이 정치에 많이 참여할 수 있을까 하는 내용이었죠. 아까 클라크 UNDP 우리 전 사무총장님께서 쿼터 시스템이 도움이 된다 하는 얘기를 이미 발제해서 하셨습니다. 저는 이게 굉장히 도움이 된다고 생각하고 한국에서도 계속해서 여성들이 아주 제가 처음 시작할 때도 매우 낮은 단계였습니다. 그러나 저도 쿼터 시스템이 있었기 때문에 정치에 들어갈 수가 있었다고 생각을 합니다. 만약 없었다고 한다면은 제가 들어가기 전에는 뭐 여성 국회의원들이 한 기에 두 명, 세 명 이런 정도에 거쳤습니다. 그런데 여성 운동을 통해서 쿼터 시스템이 필요하다 하는 얘기들을 계속해서 있어왔고 그것이 처음에는 지방의회에 도입됐다가 국회의원까지로 넘어왔고 이러면서 처음에는 아주 좀 더 낮은 뭐 30% 이렇게 하다가 다음에는 50%까지는 분명히 해야지 된다 라고 하고 그 다음에 법안을 만들어서 50%를 달성하지 채우지 않고 하는 정당은 다른 남성 국회의원들도 추천할 수 없도록 법률에 만들었습니다. 그 정도로 강력하게 만들고 나니까 여성들이 점차 많이 들어오고 또 처음에는 쿼터 시스템으로 들어왔지만은 그 경험을 통해서 그리고 그 활동을 통해서 대중들에게 알려지고 난 다음에는 지역구를 통해서 그 다음에 당선될 수가 있었습니다. 저도 처음에는 쿼터 시스템으로 그 혜택으로 들어왔지만은 그 이후에는 지역구에서 계속 당선될 수 있었기 때문에 제가 다섯 번이나 할 수 있었습니다. 그리고 그 뒤에 들어왔던 제 후배들도 많은 여성 국회의원들이 쿼터 시스템으로 들어온 다음에 지역구로 가는 저와 같은 방식을 다 밟게 되면서 많은 여성 국회의원들이 늘어났고 지금 20대 국회에서는 지역구에서 당선된 국회의원 수가 비례대표로 당선된 여성보다 더 많은 그러한 역전 현상이 일어나게 되었습니다. 그만큼 이 쿼터 시스템이라는 것이 매우 아시아처럼 또는 다른 개도국처럼 매우 낮은 단계에서는 꼭 필요한 제도라 하는 점을 말씀드립니다.
Thank you, Ms. Kwon.
Well, I want to introduce a book. it is kind of an old one. It's written in 1990. It's already like a 27 years old book. It's Bananas, Beaches, and Bases is written by Cindy Inno. Have you ever read the book? No one? Yeah. Oh, okay. You like it? Yes. It's a very well written book, and it is about women's role in international politics. She analyzed how diplomatic wives and prostitutes. And I can't remember either she displayed, she analyzed women as the major player in international politics. And so she also emphasized personal is international. And so it's very eye-opening book to analyze the whole world with the gender perspective when you want to analyze this world in gender perspective. So I would recommend to read that book, and it is also translated in Korean too. So, well, that's the...
Thank you. Kati?
Yeah.
Well, I don't have a specific answer for the politics in Finland. We don't have quotas, not for the executive boards in the companies either. But what we've been discussing is to have, for the company, we would have a recruitment process where your details would be hidden, the age or the gender or the ethnic background. So hopefully that would also help. But I put my hopes to the next generations, and then also to the process that businesses especially will understand that diversity is good business. You make better business decisions when you have diversity in your company, because we don't design products only for women or only for men. So you need also people developing these processes and products. You need diversity there. So I hope that would also advance the women's role in business, but also in politics. I think diversity is good for all of us. It's good for men as well. And there I could reply that I don't think it's against each other. It's rather cooperation. And we all should understand that the diversity, equality, non-discrimination is good for the business. It's good for the politics. It's good for all of us.
Thank you. I think the panelists, I like to advise panelists to also try to answer the first question, which was an excellent question. You know, she asked whether the perception of women fighting men should continue, or kind of standoff between men and women. So pursuing gender equality and empowering women have to be always considered in the context of a standoff between men and women and women fighting men? So that's a good question. Armida?
Thank you very much for the set of questions. I'm not sure I would like to respond yet to the question that Ambassador Ojun just reminded all of us, but I would like to give the perspective from how about if the society culturally more traditional, because we in Asia Pacific, there are still many, the societies are quite still traditional values, very patriarch society, very religious, so I think it's quite a different setting, So if that is the case, certainly I see two two avenues. One is certainly standard education, right? Education, through education for the boys and girls, both. Second, yeah, I think also very important, yeah, how to educate, yeah, in a more general sense, the leaders of the community, religious leaders. Yeah, otherwise it would be difficult, I think. Yeah. Okay, maybe in the cities, yeah, fine, yeah, but then how about, you know, the rural areas, the more traditional one? I think this issue is a big issue, yeah. If you just approach it in a standard way, you're fine, yeah, but would take a long time. So you need also a different angle of approach, culturally, religiously, yeah, socializing, education and things like that. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Helen?
Yes, great questions, thanks. And let me first respond to the one about what book has really impressed you in the area that we're talking about. If I think back to when I was young, a book that was very influential was the one by the Australian writer Germaine Greer called The Female Eunuch. It's quite an old book now, but for those interested in the history of fighting for gender equality, I recommend you go and get it out of the library. But a book that really touched my heart when I was reading a lot about development and challenges at UNDP was one that came out in 2010, written by a young Yemeni girl, and the name of it was I Am Nugood, N-U-G-O-O-D, age 10 and divorced. And she wrote her story, with help, about being 10 years old and being forcibly married by her family, which couldn't afford to keep her, to a man who was three times her age. She was raped as a prepubescent girl. Now, the extraordinary thing about this book was the courage of this girl. This girl actually managed to run away from that marriage, and she went to the courthouse in Kabul. Somehow she got to the courthouse. And she sat there and they said, little girl, what are you here for? And she said, I want a divorce. And the judge eventually came out and took her home and got her legal support. And she got her divorce and she lived to tell her tale and be a campaigner against child marriage. That really touched my heart, that book, and I recommend that you buy it. It's online. But it does remind us that there are many realities for women in our world, and the sort of challenges that I've faced in my life, they are nothing compared to what that child faced or what so many other girls and women around the world face every day. So that's a good reality check. On the question about the sort of feminist foreign policy and what can be done, look, I think it's fantastic that Sweden really stepped out with that. Canada is also very articulate on the subject of being a feminist government and having a feminist foreign policy. But if you look at governments now, which are making a big statement about gender equality, yes, there are some Western governments, like Canada, like Spain, which doesn't just have a 50% female representation cabinet, it has 61%, which is phenomenal. But there have been two very exciting examples in Africa in recent months. Ethiopia has its first ever woman president, and half the cabinet are now female, and the Chief Justice is a woman for the first time. So watch this space. Women are on the move. And not long after Ethiopia made these announcements, Rwanda, with President Paul Kagame, who I have to say, in my experience, is a fantastic advocate for women. He appointed a 50% woman cabinet as well. So there are governments out there that are really working on this. Now, for the role of the development partners like Korea, there's so much that can be done to support women. And I think from what we've been hearing from KOICA, this is very much on your minds. DFID, the big UK agency, very strong on this. The Canadians, obviously, the Scandinavian development agencies, and also Japan has made women and girls very, very central to its program as well. Very briefly on the two other questions. On the political parties, absolutely agree, quotas will make a difference fast if implemented. Secondly, I really appeal to political parties to reach out to women and encourage them to stand. That will work fast as well if political parties get the point that it is a good thing to have women's representation. And just on the first issue, which Ambassador reminded us of, I don't see these issues about a standoff between women and men. We actually don't drive through the changes without the support of men. When I spoke earlier, I referred to 1893 and a vote in the New Zealand Parliament, which was all male, which agreed that women should have the right to vote. And the rest is history in our country. We've made a lot of progress, and we've brought men along. So it's not a standoff, but we do have to advocate for our rights and for progress as we enlist support from both women and men. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Irina.
I don't believe either, like Helen Clark just said, in this standoff. I did mention, indeed, in my opening remarks that I don't see this as a women against men, but we have to admit that there was time when feminism was seen as something which is against men, and that is why I think the back off of this kind of a perception was that I would say until 10 years ago, maybe, feminism was not a good word. And nowadays, of course, the perception is totally changed. Even I remember when Prime Minister Trudeau was elected and he said, I'm a feminist. And they asked him the question, why are you a feminist? He said, because it's 21st century. And I think he was right to mention this. Or Emma Watson, one of the advocates of he/she campaign, the famous actress, British, when she stood up, I remember her very moving presentation where she said, I'm a feminist, and after that she was attacked over the social networks because of her speech. So things are complex. I don't believe in this standoff, and on the contrary, I really think that we need men as our partners because we are not, we do not want something against the men. We want to be as equal, exactly what you said, that there is a time where it won't matter whether it's he or she, but it is what they can contribute, he or she, to the society, to the job, in politics, in culture, and else. But it's a steep, I would say, road up, because still there are many stereotyping where women, unfortunately, are not giving this opportunity. And that is why we are talking here about how to create this environment and ecosystems so that they can do it. It may be recruitment without anonymous recruitments in many companies, in many countries, it is being introduced, or some other measures. Now, how to encourage women to be in politics is really also a complex issue. I have to admit, because we are here sharing personal experiences, when I was younger, I was very much against the quotas. I thought exactly like the young students ask the question, why does it matter? If we are qualified, we naturally will go into different avenues. We will just hold our lives in our hands and we will become whatever we want to. And then with the, I would say, experience, I learned that unfortunately, this is such a slow process, or it may not happen at all, that we need quotas, albeit for temporary reasons in some countries, but we need them because progress indeed is very, very slow. Now, the other is, of course, to encourage women to run in politics, and somebody said how to encourage them. Well, we have seen that if we elect a man leader who does not appeal exactly to women, I'm not mentioning countries, you all of a sudden see a huge mobilization of young women who enter into politics, and now we see that they really bring something different and they can make the change. But I think political parties and NGOs have a very big responsibility here to encourage women to run and also to educate, I would say, the general public. Well, unfortunately, it is not always that women vote for women. It is not necessary that they should vote for women necessarily. They vote for ideas. But it is important that women have more self-confidence and they also have the support both from their families, communities, and others, and this ecosystem, in order for them to run, especially when they have families, children, and others. If they don't have the support, they are very much discouraged to go into politics and to do this. Now, when we come, and I come to the first question again, when the whole structure of society has to change, because it's in many traditional societies, when there are some cultural angles that you have to tackle here. In fact, when we speak about women's empowerment, it means you have to change the structure, the social, the political, the economic structure of society. And this is not easy. It really brings a total change. And in order to accelerate that, we really need all the different actors to come, be it traditional leaders, religious leaders, and others. We have to have them on our side. And in the big majority of cases, these are men. So we need them on our side. We need to convince them first that it is good for them, it is good for families, for societies, and that is why I was mentioning that we need men. And small countries. I think Sweden is an excellent example. Sweden is a big country when we speak about gender equality. And in this context, there are not big and small countries. There are countries which, by example, can lead and can make change also with leading to the others. So I don't think here we should speak about big and small countries. We will speak about rather the powerful of example and of ideas who's come, as famously the French writer said Victor Hugo, the power of an idea whose time has come is unmatched. And I think this is what we are speaking here when we speak about gender equality. And last, the book, when I was young, probably the book that impacted it most was Anna Karenina by Tolstoy, where we have seen really how the cultural norms and where we have seen the societals and others were really having a young rebellious woman suffocating.
Last but not least, Sabine.
Maybe on the question which approach works the best in promoting gender equality. Well, this always depends on the context, obviously where we are working and there's different methods. But as we as women do not exactly start from the same platform due to a lot of patriarchal structures, laws, and so on, therefore these temporary measures and other things are very often really needed to bring women also to that level. I was recently in a really interesting conference where we were from all over the world, and they did a little experiment with us. They said, can you now all think back of what your mom and your dad said to you when you were 4 years old? And we all did. And you guess what? We all had the same answers, no matter from where we came all over the world. It was, you know, respect your parents, your grandparents, don't quarrel with your brother and sister, don't steal, don't lie, you know. The human factors, this was all the same for all of us, no matter whether we were men or women, and no matter from which part of the world we came. And I think to come back to these basics, and then of course we are going through socialization, through different experiences in different countries and so on, but always coming back to this core of who we are as human beings and respecting each other, I think this should be the guiding principles and when we are working towards gender equality and really getting rid of these stereotypes and the barriers that still exist in our world. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much. Unfortunately, I have to take my words back because we don't have time for a second round. If any of you have absolutely important questions, you might approach the panelists individually after the end of the session. I think we had a very, very fruitful, very, very good, very inspiring conversation and discussions during this session. Would you like to give a big hand to this power group of panelists? Thank you and have a good evening.
Ladies and gentlemen, that brings us to the end of our first day of the GEEF 2019. I hope you enjoyed the opening ceremony, the live artwork, our session on health, our session on women empowerment. Please be back tomorrow for the second day at 9 o'clock here in the Centennial Hall. Thank you very much.